Press conference, Cipriano, press conference. Take one.
In an interval?
I am in Brussels for two purposes. The one is to have talks with the Prime Minister of Belgium, Mr. Tindemans, whom I'm meeting tomorrow. And the second purpose was to have some talks with the President of the Commission of the European Economic Community, Mr. Jenkins, with whom we've had already our talks, both at lunchtime and before lunchtime and after lunchtime. With the Prime Minister of Belgium, we shall.
Base d'autres.
Clap two.
As it is well known, we are already associated, and the object of our discussion was when shall we start the exploratory talks with regard to the second stage of our association agreement. And we have agreed that the exploratory talks will start in March of next year. And the whole process of the exploratory talks and the negotiations will, as it was confidently stated by both sides, will be completed by the end of 1969, at the time that the first stage ends. So the timetable has been agreed regarding the second stage of our association with the community. From while in Brussels, I had the opportunity of meeting with the President of the Senate and the President of the Assembly.
Madam, clip three.
Insist that the resolutions of the United Nations, which were unanimously adopted, resolution 3212, which was reaffirmed by a series of other resolutions, and which was endorsed by the Security Council, and therefore it became mandatory, should be implemented. And the members of the United Nations, and especially the more powerful ones, have the obligation to see the resolution which they voted for implemented, because this resolution provides and contains the basic prerequisites for lasting peace and a just solution to the Cyprus problem. The one basic prerequisite is the withdrawal of the foreign troops from the Republic of Cyprus. The other basic prerequisite is the return of the refugees to their homes. In connection with this resolution of the United Nations, and in an effort to give an answer to a question which quite often arises, namely the question of the security of the Turkish Cypriots, A few months ago, I put forward a proposal which I intend to repeat before the General Assembly again this time. It has been argued that the Turkish troops are in Cyprus for the protection of the Turkish Cypriots. I'm quite certain that the majority of the Turkish Cypriots do not agree with that. I'm quite certain about that because there is another aspect. And if the Turkish troops are in Cyprus for the protection of the Turkish Cypriots, what about the settlers from Turkey? Are they also there for the protection of the Turkish Cypriots? Obviously, neither the presence of the Turkish troops nor that of the settlers has anything to do with the interests of the Turkish Cypriots. But let us take it at its face value and say that there is a question of security involved. I proposed that Cyprus should be completely demilitarized and completely disarmed. Not a single person should have the right to be armed, either Greek or Turkish, or anyone. Completely disarmed. The Turkish troops to be withdrawn. All the other troops to be withdrawn. The Cyprus army to be dismantled, to dissolve, and disarm everybody and have only a small Cypriot police force composed of Greek Cypriots and Turkish Cypriots under the supervision, the guidance, and the control of an international police force for an indefinite period of time, which would be answerable to the Security Council. Having this international police force in control, really, of the policing of the island for a long period of time, no one should seriously say that there would still be a question of security. In such circumstances, the reconciliation and the reunion of the Greek Cypriots and the Turkish Cypriots would be easily achieved. In fact, a solution to the Cyprus problem in such circumstances will be a matter of days, because I know very well what the Greek Cypriots feel. And I know very well by now what the vast majority of the Turkish Cypriots want. They want to be left alone so they can cooperate again and create a better future for them in peace, in harmony. Sometimes the Cyprus problem is forgotten because there is no bloodshed. Usually, problems remain alive for as long as there is bloodshed. The problem of Cyprus cannot be forgotten, because it is a permanent wound. Which must not become absolutely permanent. It's a wound that must be healed, not only in the interests of the people of Cyprus, but also in the interests of international peace and security. I believe.
Schreder.